Hello, welcome to P's and G's. My name is Jo and I'm on the staff team here. It is so great that you have managed to find the time to log on and join us. As we come together now to worship, let's pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity in our weeks to focus and refocus on you. And as we come together to worship, I pray that you will help each and every one of us to refocus our eyes on you, to put down all the things that we've been carrying with us this week. And Lord, I pray that you meet each and every one of us wherever we are as we worship you now. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessing flows. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above you, heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Praise him for he has overcome.
clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare His praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. A God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
I'm joined today by David Strang, who has kindly agreed to be interviewed for our series of interviews about the Beatitudes. David, it's so great that you have given us this time to join us today. Can you tell us a little bit more about you for those of us who don't know you very well?
Of course. Yeah, so my name's David Strang, and I was a member here at P's and G's with my wife Alison and family for 16 years until 4 years ago when Alice and I went to Mustard Seed. So we were part of the church plant from P's and G's to Mustard Seed in Easter Road. And in terms of my work, when we want to ask me about leadership, I have worked mainly in justice. I had 33 years as a police officer, both in London and the Metropolitan Police, and then in Scotland. Here at the time it was Lothian and Borders Police and Dumfries and Galloway Constabulary. And then for 5 years, I was Her Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland. So that was, I spent 5 years going around the 15 prisons in Scotland and reporting on the conditions and the treatment of people detained in prison. And for the last couple of years, I've been chairing a mental health inquiry in Tayside, final report of which I published last week. So that's what I've been up to.
Gosh. Can you tell us a little bit about how your Christian faith has really helped you and influenced the way that you have led in those roles?
Yeah, so when you begin in the police, you start as a constable, and I was in Holloway Police Station in North London, and I was a Christian before I joined the police. I felt that God had called me to serve in the Met in London. And I remember wondering if I was the only Christian in the whole of the Metropolitan Police of 28,000 plus. And that was simply because I was the only Christian on my team, and your team that you're with is kind of a really significant impact. So I learned to be a team member, but I was soon on an accelerated promotion course, and I was a police inspector within 5 years. And what I remember noticing really distinctly was how much easier it was to be a Christian once I got into that leadership position, because I mean, the workplace is a really hard place for Christians, and particularly young Christians. Yeah. There's so much pressure to conform, to behave in certain ways, and so on. And what I found was that the more senior I went, the easier it was to be different and to set standards. Mm-hmm. And I mean, people didn't expect senior officers to swear and so on as they would maybe on the front line. So I found it easier to display those values and traits of being a Christian in senior positions in the police.
Wow, that's really interesting, because it's quite difficult, isn't it, when you are a junior sort of rank and file, to maybe set yourself apart. But you're saying that actually when you're more senior, you have more autonomy to be able to set a precedent. Is that right?
Yeah, so more autonomy to be yourself, I think. Mm. Often it's difficult to be yourself if you're on a close-knit team. Although people who do, are authentic Christians, are hugely valued on teams. So sure. People might be surprised at first and notice things about you. But I think the other thing about senior leadership is not just the ability to be yourself, but have an ability to set the tone for the team. So as a police inspector, I was in charge of a team of 25 or 30 people.
And do you feel that your team responded to you differently? Did they recognise that you did hold different values and led in a slightly different way?
I think, well, they did, and I think people appreciated that, and particularly perhaps people whose natural style is more like mine. So, there's often a kind of sense that to be a leader, particularly perhaps in a uniform organisation like the church or in the law or finance or whatever, there are some adjectives that people would use for leadership, such as being strong and firm and robust and ruthless and single-minded, all of those things which have a hard edge to them. Mm. And for me, what informed my values was not just about the value of people and human beings, but think particularly of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, where Paul talks about gentleness and kindness and self-control and patience. And I think what I was able to demonstrate to people, and it wasn't deliberate, it just happened, but that it is possible to treat people well, to treat them with respect, with dignity, to show kindness, gentleness, and still be a very effective leader. And the other thing that has always been hugely important to me has been building a team, so taking your team with you. So it's, leadership is not a one-person activity. It is about, or in my experience and all work that I've done, it's about getting the best from others. So people thrive on encouragement, appreciation. And I know that if you notice what someone has done and say, well done and thank you, they really value that and will remember that.
Mm. Yeah, and setting a totally different culture from one of fear or intimidation as a leadership style as well, which is very interesting.
Yeah.
And then my sort of final little question is, thinking about leaders in our political and other industry world. What do you think we should be praying for them right now?
Well, we should certainly be praying for our leaders because they're under high pressure all the time. But I think I think what I would want to pray for leaders is for integrity. So I think there's so much pressure to conform to other people's expectations. I think the allure of leadership can be very strong. So thinking about position, status, authority, power, wealth, you know, all those things that young people may be aspiring to achieve. Well, actually, you talk about the Sermon on the Mount and the Beatitudes, where Jesus is turning that completely upside down. And so I believe that leaders are called to serve.
Mm-hmm.
So I think integrity, authenticity,
mm-hmm.
and I would argue compassion. You know, that's mm-hmm. about treating people well. So I would, those are the three things that I would pray for leaders in whatever sphere, including leaders in the church.
That's great, and I'll pray into that in a moment. And can I just ask you what I can be praying for you as well, what we can be praying for you?
Well, thank you. So I said that I'm a member at Mustard Seed, and there's some very exciting things happening at Mustard Seed. We've got a weekly Friday breakfast, and we've recently started Christians Against Poverty drop-in cafes. And I think just praying for us as a community as we move out of lockdown.
Mm.
It feels that there's a lot of uncertainty, and some of the things that we really valued and appreciated in the early years about meeting together and having meals and supporting one another, that feels in a way like a distant memory. So we're really looking forward to kind of re-establishing connections and relationships in a way that have been disjointed over the last 18 months.
Yeah, that sounds great. I thank you very much. I will definitely pray for you. Can I pray for you now?
Please do. That's great. Thank you.
Father, I thank you so much for David and all that he has shared today. I thank you for his wisdom and all that he has learnt and demonstrated and modelled in all of the jobs that he's been part of. Thank you that you've had your hand upon him to be light in his workplace and to demonstrate a different way of leading. And I pray, Father God, for him and for Mustard Seed and all of the things that they are now journeying in to reach out to their community for people who are struggling with debt, and especially as they start coming back together as a community after this difficult time of COVID. We just really pray your hand upon that church community and upon David especially. And Lord, we lift up to you our leaders across the world, but particularly our political leaders who are facing difficult things right now, and also just taking a moment to think about all of the leaders that we work underneath right now. We lift them into your hands, and we pray, Father God, that instead of going after the things that the world sets as priority, whether it be wealth, power, status, Lord, we just pray for our leaders that those things that David has mentioned, that integrity, that authenticity and compassion, and that way of managing people will that we learn about in the Beatitudes will be something that separates them out, Lord. We pray your hand upon them and your blessing upon them. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Thanks, David. And now Dave is going to lead us in our intercessions.
Thanks, Joe, and in particular, thanks to David. Well, in just under 100 days' time, Glasgow will host COP26, which is the United Nations Summit on Climate Change. And as we are enjoying this hot weather, other people around the world are going through different extremes of weather conditions, floods and other extreme weather. So as we pray for the world, the church and ourselves, let's pray that we might be good stewards of God's creation. When I say, Lord, this is your world, can you respond, help us to live at peace? Lord, this is your world, help us to live at peace. Father, we thank you for the beauty of your creation, for mountains and lochs, for oceans and deserts, for stunning sunrises and sunsets that take our breath away. Thank you for this time of year when so many of us get fresh glimpses of the majesty of your creation and our souls are refreshed by being at the beach, climbing a Munro, or simply enjoying the cool of a forest. But we also recognise the changes that we are seeing around the world. Deforestation, droughts and floods. Please give us wisdom in how we use the natural resources of our planet. Lord, this is your world. Help us to live at peace. We pray for those affected by extreme weather conditions, for those made homeless or bereaved by the rains in China, Germany, the Netherlands and Belgium. But we also pray for those bearing the brunt of climate change in sub-Saharan Africa, in South America and the Far East. We pray for one of our mission partners, Rachel Mash, in her work with the Anglican Church in Southern Africa, helping their leaders and members to be informed and to pray and live differently in response to climate change. We pray for Rachel as she helps prepare for the Lambeth Conference in 2023, as hundreds of bishops from around the globe will gather to meet, talk and pray. Please guide Rachel as she prepares a whole day's programme on climate change, that the bishops will be inspired but also be given practical steps that they can take back to the Anglican Church around the world. Lord, this is your world. Help us to live at peace. We pray for this nation, for rest and refreshment after 16 months of the pandemic. In particular, we pray for our political and civic leaders. After the grueling last year, please give them time and space for reflection, recreation, and rest. And we do pray for the economic effects of the pandemic, for the supply chains of food, for the equal distribution of the vaccine around the world, and for the consequences we do not yet see, but which we will feel for many years to come. Lord, this is your world. Help us to live at peace. And we pray for the church in China, Germany, the Netherlands, and Belgium, as it seeks to bring compassion and comfort to those affected by the floods. And for your church in Kenya, Uganda, Ethiopia and Sudan, as they help people deal with the effects of climate change. And today we pray for the community in Padua, northern Uganda, that many of us support through World Vision. Be with Pastor Paul as he leads an Anglican church of 4,000 in that region. May that church know your peace and reassurance. Lord, this is your world. Help us to live at peace. And we pray for your church in Scotland and here in Edinburgh. Help us to be salt and light where we live. Help us to be kind and compassionate, patient and wise, always prepared to give a reason for the hope that is within us, and strengthen and sustain us, that more people might see Jesus in us and come to know him for themselves. Lord, this is your world. Help us to live at peace. Finally, we pray for those who are especially in need of your power today, for those feeling anxious and fearful, for those facing surgery or serious medical treatment, for those caring for elderly or ill family members. May they know your peace, your power and your presence today. Lord, this is your world. Help us to live at peace. And we draw our prayers together as together we say, Merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks, Dave. Now we're going to have our reading, which is brought to us by Fleur, and then Ailey is going to continue our preaching series looking at the Beatitudes.
Today's reading is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Thank you, Fleur. Well, if you've been with us the past couple of weeks, You'll know that we're looking at the Beatitudes, this very famous sermon given by Jesus. We can't really talk about the Beatitudes without speaking about the kingdom of God. In chapter 4, it tells us that Jesus travelled throughout Galilee preaching the coming of the kingdom. And we see that he teaches this in chapters 5 to 7. And then by the time he moves on to chapters 8 and 9, we see Jesus demonstrating the power of the kingdom with healings and miracles. The kingdom of God is wherever God is ruling. And while these Beatitudes could feel like a list of instructions, you must try to be merciful, you must try to be meek, and so on, Jesus is actually showing us how things will be in the kingdom of God, under God's rule. See, the kingdom of God came breaking into this world in the person of Jesus, and it's been rolling out ever since. With each encounter and conversation with an unlikely person, Jesus is bringing in the kingdom. With each healing, every miracle and exorcism, he is bringing in the kingdom. When he's teaching crowds or when he's challenging religious authorities, Jesus is bringing in the kingdom of God. The theologian Tom Wright puts it really nicely when he says this: the life of heaven, the realm where God is already king, is to become the life of the world, transforming the present earth into the place of beauty and delight that God always intended. He goes on to link it to these Beatitudes. These Beatitudes are a summons to live in the present in the way that makes sense in God's promised future, because that future has arrived now in Jesus of Nazareth. So, blessed are the meek then, for they shall inherit the earth. Perhaps, like me, you look around and you don't see the meek being rewarded. They don't tend to inherit much, never mind the whole earth. We look at this word meek, and I wonder what it means for us today. This verse is showing us that if our identity is in Christ, then two things happen. We can be content, and we can have confidence. We can be content in the kingdom we are in here and now, and we can be confident of our inheritance ahead. The internet tells me that cassette, kerfuffle, and gallivant are all words we no longer use. They have fallen out of fashion. And I wonder if this word meek would lie redundant alongside these words. I wonder what images come to mind when you hear the word meek. What kind of person might you imagine? The word meek is not something that most of us would include on our CVs, I imagine. And so it's really interesting to see how the Bible uses this word. The Greek word that's used is praus, and it describes a reserved strength, a person who could exhibit great power, but who instead chooses to be gentle. It's power under control. Now, I hesitate to use this example, but can we think about competing with a child? Perhaps a child challenges you to a running race or an arm wrestle or a game of snap. And what do we do there? As adults, most of us will go easy on the child, perhaps let the child win. We hold back our own strength. We choose to be gentle. Now, this doesn't mean we're weak. We have the power, but we're controlling it. And that's a sign of maturity. We don't need to prove ourselves. We're content to know that we are the adult and they are the children. Power under control is meekness. And of course, Jesus is talking about being meek under God, putting our power into his hands. Jesus describes himself as being gentle and humble in heart, which paints a picture of meekness. But as is always the case with Jesus, he doesn't just talk the talk, he is meek. Throughout his life and his ministry, he walks the walk. And this is particularly obvious as he journeys towards the cross. When Jesus is arrested, we can read about this later on in the book of Matthew in chapter 26. He doesn't object to being arrested. He doesn't fight. One of his companions does. He even pulls out a sword and cuts off the ear of one of the men who is sent to arrest Jesus. And Jesus says, no, we don't do things by the sword. That's not how God's kingdom is coming. It's not by muscle or force. But then we see just how much power Jesus has and how he has submitted it to God's control. Jesus says this, do you think I cannot call on my Father? And he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels. That's 72,000 angels, by the way. Jesus says, I'm not going to do that, because then scripture would not be fulfilled. See, Jesus knows what's coming, and he says it's all been written about in the prophecies. And we see an example of that in Isaiah 53. He says, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Jesus put his power under the control of God. Meekness. Let's go back to that example of the child that you have allowed to beat you in an arm wrestle. Can we imagine that child being bullied in the playground, or maybe attacked by an animal? What do we do then? Are we content to stand by and watch? Well, this is when the meek do assert their power, because that's another trait of meekness, exercising power for the benefit of others rather than ourselves. And Jesus showed this perfectly. When he spoke out, he was always acting on behalf of other people. The anger was never for himself. The most famous example of this is when he cleared the temple. On seeing the profiteering and extortion going on in the temple, he turned over the tables and he threw the money changers out. He wasn't angry for himself there, but he was acting on behalf of the poor and those who were being taken advantage of. Meekness, using our power under God's control. So meekness, it's not weakness, it's not passive, it's good and right for us to speak up for others and act for justice. Another writer says that being meek is to have a true view of oneself, a true view of self. And I think there's a spectrum here. We've all met people who think highly of themselves. There is no one better, no one stronger, no one faster. We might say they have a big ticket on themselves. They might be the ones who would try to beat a child at an arm wrestle. But then at the other end of the spectrum, we have self-loathing. People who have no worth, they think themselves useless. And neither of these ends of the spectrum are good. Eugene Peterson translated this particular beatitude to read, "You're blessed when you're content with just who you are, no more, no less." I thought that's quite helpful. Content with just who you are, no more, and no less. And I wonder who of us can claim to be content with who we are, with who God has made us to be, a true view of self. The Apostle Paul is someone who is known for being content, and he famously says this in Philippians 4. I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want, I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Paul is so secure in his identity in Christ. He can be content in all things. And there's great freedom in this. We don't need to concern ourselves worrying about what others think about us. We don't need to strive to be better or to get ahead. We can trust in God's plans and his timing. It can feel like those who hustle and strive and network, even cheat, are always the ones who win. We can never compete and we will never have as much as them. And so we can start to work hard. We might want more power. We might want more money. And we think that that will bring us contentment. But all of a sudden, the very thing that we thought would make us content ends up ensnaring us, and it traps us. And we're in this cycle of trying to get more and have more and be more. And we realize these things will never bring us contentment, and we're trapped in that cycle. So what does bring contentment? What brings this freedom? Well, can we go back to look at Psalm 37, which is what Jesus is quoting from with this beatitude? Let me read some of it. And I wonder, as I read it, can you listen out? Where is the psalmist's focus? Do not fret because of those who are evil, or be anxious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Trust in the Lord. Take delight in the Lord. Where is my focus? Often it's on me, on my stuff, on what I'm doing, what I'm not doing, what others are doing that I'm not doing. Where's the psalmist's focus? It's on the Lord. He is worshiping God. And when our focus is on God, everything else is given its proper place. Worship shifts our perspective and priorities, and that's when contentment comes. But it's not just about being content in the now. We have an inheritance we can look forward to with confidence. I don't know if you've ever inherited anything. I once inherited a car from my grandparents. It was not flashy by any stretch. It was a Nissan Sunny, but it was amazing. As a side note, it also had a cassette player. All of a sudden, I could stop scrimping and saving to buy my own car, and I didn't need to get two buses to take me to work each day, and the freedom. I could go to the supermarket and fill my boot. I could pick up friends and give them lifts. I could visit family. I could go to IKEA. So much joy. Now, I'd paid nothing for this car. Let's not talk at the moment about the surprise I had in my early 20s of things like road tax and insurance and parking permits and petrol and the stress of getting through an MOT. The point was that I had this car, and with it came privilege and pleasure. I did nothing to earn it. Now here, Jesus is not talking about a car. He's talking about inheriting the earth. Inheriting land in biblical times was significant. That was partly because it brought prosperity and security. Back to that psalm again, Psalm 37, it mentions this repeatedly. Those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. A little while and the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity. The psalm says it's not those fighting for power or wealth who will ultimately enjoy the inheritance of his security. The meek will. We're used to armies being sent into battle, shedding their blood to win land for their king or their ruler. And here in the kingdom of God, we see Jesus shedding his own blood and passing the inheritance on to his people. Now that really is an upside down kingdom. As Jesus lay on the cross under the power of a brutal Roman Empire, nothing seemed weaker. And yet by Easter Sunday, it was a different story. So what about this future inheritance? Perhaps we have an image of the kingdom of God being the place called heaven. It might be far away, and is where we will go to escape this earth and all its turmoil. Well, the book of Revelation tells us that heaven is God's space. And while our present reality interlocks with heaven at points, we've maybe heard people talk of glimpses of heaven or thin places, for example. One day heaven and earth will join forever, and God will dwell with his people there. And there is an inheritance to be confident in. Jesus began to roll out the kingdom of God, not in force, but in meekness. And it's proven to be unstoppable ever since. Let me finish with a quote from Glenn Scrivener. He says this: within a couple of centuries, the empire that crucified Jesus in weakness hailed him as Lord and God. And today his movement is sweeping the globe. The meek really do inherit the earth. So the person of Jesus shows us that we can live contented lives in the kingdom now and also have confidence in our inheritance to come. Maybe we'll remember that next time we accept a challenge to play snap with a child. Amen.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last, your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. You've never failed me yet. I never will forget that you've never failed me yet.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. For I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, never let go. Through the calm and through the storm, oh no, never let go. In every high, in every low, oh no, never let go. Lord, you never let go of me. Cause I can see the light that is coming for the heart that holds on. The glorious light beyond the compare. Be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, I live to know you here on the earth, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. But until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Cause I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you. Still I will praise you. Oh no, never let go. Through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, you never let go. In every high, every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me.
Let us pray. Father God, thank you so much for the words that you have spoken to us through Ailey today and the words of that beatitude. We pray, Father God, that this week we will live countercultural lives that demonstrate that your kingdom is here and that your kingdom is coming. We pray, Lord God, that you help us in this. We cry out to you because we know that we cannot do this in our own strength. Please be with us this week in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us. It has been such a pleasure to be with you, and we really hope that you have great weeks. If you are based in and around Edinburgh, please come and join us here physically if you're able to. We would love to see you. And if you're not, then we still love you and hope that you have an amazing week, and we will see you soon.